ladies and gentlemen. Bishop Clarence and the Archbishop will be in the centre. On their side, immediate side, will be the common cup, and on the far side, on either side, will be a cup for intention. There are little signs on the floor if you get a bit confused as to where you should go, so please make sure you look at that before having communion. It's lovely to welcome Archbishop Philip and Joy with us this evening, and all other guests that we have with us. A special welcome for one of our guests who will come during the acknowledgement of country. Please stay on for afters. As so often happens with these things of good Anglican functions, there is far more food than there is people. So please stay on and share in a light supper afterwards. And also, tomorrow morning we have Eucharist at 7:30, and there will be breakfast after that Eucharist. You don't have to come to the Eucharist to get breakfast. But there is breakfast in Pembroke Hall tomorrow morning at 8 o'clock before the next session of Synod starts. Would you please stand for our entrance here?
Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God, King, and Lord.
Christ is risen, hallelujah.
He is risen indeed,
as we gather, we acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which this cathedral stands, the Wangaratta people. We pay our respects to the elders. We acknowledge Uncle Clay Lovely, who is with us tonight, and offer respect to any other Aboriginal or Torres Strait elders who are present. We pray for all First Nations people as we seek to respond faithfully to the invitation to journey together for justice and reconciliation.
Let us pray.
Thank you.
O God, who told the hearts of your faithful people by sending to them the light of your Holy Spirit, grant us the same Spirit to have a right judgment in all things, and evermore rejoice in his holy comfort, through the merits of Christ Jesus our Saviour, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the same Spirit, one God, now and forever.
A reading from the book of the prophet Ezekiel. The hand of the Lord came upon me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord, and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me all around them. There were very many lying in the valley, and they were very dry. He said to me, "Mortal, can these bones live?" I answered, "O Lord God, you know." Then he said to me, "Prophesy to these bones, and say to them, 'O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. I will lay sinews on you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live, and you shall know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I had been commanded. And as I prophesied, suddenly there was a noise, a rattling, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and there were sinews on them, and flesh had come upon them, and skin had covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, "Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, mortal, and say to the breath, Thus says the Lord God, Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon these slain, that they may live." I prophesied as he commanded me, and the breath came into them, and they lived and stood on their feet, a vast multitude. Then he said to me, "Mortal, these bones are the whole house of Israel. They say, 'Our bones are dried up, and our hope is lost. We are cut off completely.' Therefore, prophesy and say to them, 'Thus says the Lord God, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. And I will bring you back to the land of Israel. And you shall know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from your graves, O my people. I will put my spirit within you, and you shall live. And I will place you on your own soil. Then you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken and will act, says the Lord." For the word of the Lord.
reading from the letter of Paul to the Galatians. For you are called to freedom, brothers and sisters, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for self-indulgence, but through love become slaves to one another. For the whole law is summed up in a single commandment: you shall love your neighbour as yourself. If, however, you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. Live by the Spirit, I say, and do not gratify the desires of the flesh. For what the flesh desires is opposed to the Spirit, and what the Spirit desires is opposed to the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to prevent you from doing what you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not subject to the law. Now the works of the flesh are obvious: fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmities, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I am warning you, as I warned you before, those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against such things. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also be guided by the Spirit. Let us not become conceited, competing against one another, envying one another. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. disciples, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to be with you forever. This is the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him because he abides with you and he will be in you. I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. In a little while, the world will no longer see me, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will know that I am in my Father, and you in me, and I in you. They who have my commandments and keep them are those who love me. And those who love me will be loved by my Father. And I will love them and reveal myself to them." Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, "Lord, how is it that you will reveal yourself to us and not to the world?" Jesus answered him, "Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but is from the Father who sent me. I have said these things to you while I am still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid." This is the Gospel of the Lord.
May the words of my lips and the thoughts of all our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
Well, a great pleasure to join with you. You've had all the work and I've had all the enjoyment of a quiet drive up and down to see you refreshed from your day at Synod. The first reading is one of those very evocative ones, one that comes from some sort of a vision that Ezekiel had. And I'm sure it was evocative for the people who first heard that vision. A valley of dry bones, it almost sounds a bit like a dystopian kind of picture. But I think for the people of his world, it would have evoked a tragedy of some kind or other. Perhaps the decimation of warriors in battle, perhaps people killed by some raiding party and their bodies just left in their place, perhaps people who just died of hunger or starvation and drought. And tragically, there are probably still parts of the world where we would encounter such scenes. So the vision of the Spirit, the breath of God coming to enliven those bones, and step by step, as we heard in that Ezekiel reading, come back to life, is something which seems the total reversal of whatever tragedy it was that brought that scene into existence in the first place. So I think to the first hearers of Ezekiel's prophecy, the revelation of his vision, this would have seemed truly remarkable. And as he carries it through, he talks about the people being restored to their land, not left, as it were, as people just dry bones there, but in no way inhabiting the place of promise that God had brought them to. And then we heard in the psalm how, as it is, we know that when our breath stops, we are dead, and when we are given breath, we are alive. This strong picture of most life itself being nurtured by something which is intangible. Now, of course, we know all the scientific reasons of why we breathe. You can tell me all the chemical elements that work inside your body. You probably all know about your metabolism and the things that are involved. Some of you probably can tell me about the tricarboxylic acid cycle and the various things that you've learnt in university or in high school. But to people who first encountered these things, these were wonderful mysteries. That something that was as intangible as breath gave life. And when it was spent, there was no life. See, we live in an age where we don't have much mystery. We kind of think we know everything. Everything can be analysed, it can be explained, it can be pulled apart, even wonderfully intervened in medically, which some of us are very grateful for experiences we've had. But to the people of a more ancient world, these were wonders and mysteries, and there were signs of God's presence. There's something that was, as it were, numinous. You know, you couldn't grasp it or seize it. Something which was almost like an extension of God who you couldn't grasp or see was the animating force inside a human life. And so it was very easy, I think, for people of that more ancient world to grasp a sense when Jesus spoke about the Spirit, sending his Spirit to be with them, the Spirit of his Father to be with them, that this would be life for them. This is the Spirit of truth, he says. The Spirit abides with you and will be in you. And then oddly enough, of course, the world, the people who are living in the flesh, can't perceive that Spirit because they're very materialistic. Almost, it's what it means to live in the flesh. It's just sort of rooted to the material things. You don't seize and apprehend the spiritual things. And Jesus knows that without this living reality present amongst his disciples, it would almost feel as if when he left them, they'd feel abandoned. And so he says, I will not leave you orphaned. I am coming to you. That this abiding presence of his love, of his presence, of God's love through the Spirit, wonderfully working in the life of the Christian community and the Christian believer, is that animating force for good, as we heard in the epistle reading. All the wonderful things which make a person filled with the Spirit such a blessing to others and to the world, and probably capable of living a vastly less complicated life for themselves than those who live to the flesh and in the flesh. Those who love me will keep my word, and my Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. What a glorious thing we celebrate, that God, Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Spirit, comes to us, inhabits our life of community, inhabits each of us in a miraculous way, and makes their home amongst us. So when you come to a synod, I don't know what you think a synod is about. Some things will come to your mind, but a synod is a walking together. That's what it means. Synodos, a walking together. like the walking together of those disciples on the road to Emmaus, walking with Jesus, not initially even knowing who they're walking with, but in the walking, in the talking, discerning God's presence, the risen Christ amongst them, to transform their vision, to give them a new way of life, a new way of looking at the world. And I hope that's your abiding memory of a synod. In some of the other work I do as the chair of the Anglican Roman Catholic International Commission, ARCIC, we are looking at moral discernment in the church. The earlier part of our work was about how we walk together, and we had a publication, Walking Together in the Way. And as you know, I hope you know, that the Roman Catholic Church, at the direction of Pope Francis, is exploring what they're calling synodality. And it's interesting because Anglicans, because we really got into this in about the 19th century, synods, we talk about being synodical, which I think it often means to us, you know, being in a meeting. If when I say synod, you think a meeting. You think canons and acts and laws and, you know, kind of procedural things. And at its worst effort, you know, those with the most votes win the argument. And the others look there a bit sad because they couldn't muster enough votes. And that's kind of one caricature of being synodical. But as my Catholic colleagues tell me, they say, look, you Anglicans get so stuck on being synodical, you actually don't really understand what it means to be synodal. And they say, you know, things like the Lambeth Conference, clearly they're synodal, because we've got all the bishops gathered together, and that because of the Spirit's presence, it confers a certain authority to what happens. And I'll open that some more tomorrow as we have a chance to look at the Lambeth calls. And I think that there is a really big invitation for Anglicans to, as it were, re-receive synodality. Because at its worst, I think our efforts of being synodical have meant we become parliamentary. It's kind of parliamentarianism, not the synodality of the walking together as disciples on the road with Jesus, knowing the presence of the Spirit, and in that way being able to discern the Father's will for us. And at its most wonderful expression, that is the life of a synod. And I hope that you contribute to the synod in that spirit and receive from the Spirit your experience of synod in that way. In the reception of the nature of Christ, the Christology, we understand that Christ has three offices: prophet, priest, and king. And we understand that these, what I call the tria munera, the three works of the church, because Christ is Christ's church, Christ inhabits the church, that those three works continue alive in the church: prophet, priest, and king. And you can see that reflected in some of the ways the church is ordered and how it interacts with the world. And it really is that kingly work that is part of church governance. From the ancient times, it was church assemblies were only ever could be gathered by the emperor or the king. There was a great tussle through the Middle Ages between the kings and the popes or the bishops as to who actually had that kingly power, that power, that magisterial power, the power to be the one who could convene things to set order. And it's interesting, you know, when Henry VIII, the Reformation in England, evicting the Pope from that magisterial power, what did he do? Well, he took it to himself. And it was high treason to assemble an assembly of the church without the king's command. And Charles Perry, our first bishop, the Bishop of Melbourne, who came to Victoria in the 1840s, was very eager that his episcopal ministry not be a tyranny to people. And he wanted to gather and exercise his responsibilities in the light of the gathering of the clergy and the people. And he was one of the pioneers of that synodical movement in the Anglican Communion. But he was very concerned because he didn't know how far that law of Henry VIII reached into Victoria. And he had to spend a lot of time in England establishing that he was not going to get charged for high treason, which would be a capital offence, for convening a synod. A lot of negotiations in England with parliamentarians and people who were sympathetic to that reform. And so, you see, we inherit something which is looks simple and easy and uncomplicated to us, but it is one of the great offices that Christ confers upon the Church. And, of course, its most wonderful expression would be a general council of the Church, as we receive these important doctrines, things that come from Chalcedon or Nicaea or other places, the councils where the Church universally gathered and can be most authoritative in its teaching on matters of doctrine and order. And we receive and inhabit those things from those ancient times as churches of who receive the historic Christian teachings of orthodoxy. So these three works of the Church are generally alive in a synod. Prophecy, speaking the life-giving breath of God to the world. It's a great thing when there are lots of motions of synod that are concerned about the world, about justice, about peace, about the things that the world desperately searches to receive. It's important that we have here an exercising the priestly, if the office of priest was a sacrificial ministry in the Old Testament. And so Christ's sacrifice, the cross, is this priestly ministry that is inhabiting the Church. So us repeating his sacrifice in the Eucharist, recognizing his presence amongst us and his call to be people worthy of that work and that office of his is a powerful thing, as well as our work in exercising that kingly role in ordering matters for the sake of the Church in ways that are part of our authority and responsibility. And all this we do through Christ, through his Spirit, in obedience and in the presence of God his Father. And we'll have the chance of unfolding that wonderful mystery of God's revelation to us, three persons in one God, at Trinity Sunday. So I feel blessed to be amongst you. I feel blessed to be in this holy place and to be present at a holy assembly of God's people. Bishop, priests, deacons, and the holy lay people of God in this diocese. A wonderful treasure God puts in your hands, fills in your hearts, informs in your minds to do the work of the Church in our place, in our time. May God's Spirit of grace and peace rest wonderfully upon you in all your doings.
So now let us pray for the world and for the Church.
To the bidding, Lord, come to us, responses, and fill us with your Spirit. Generous God, we thank you for the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray for the survivors of violence, abuse, and neglect. Give your power to the powerless, your fullness to the empty of spirit. Heal their wounds, free them from fear, and restore them to wholeness of life. We ask that we may be strengthened to serve you better. Lord, come to bless us and fill us with your Spirit. We thank you for the wisdom of your Holy Spirit. Give wisdom and understanding to our Bishop Clarence and to all the members of the Synod of this diocese. Teach us in all things to seek first your honour and glory. May we perceive what is right, have courage to pursue it, and grace to accomplish it. We ask you to make us wise to understand your will. Lord, come to bless us and fill us with your Spirit. We thank you for the peace of your Holy Spirit. God of the nations, whose sovereign rule brings justice and peace, have mercy on our broken and divided world. Shed abroad your peace in the hearts of all, and banish from them the spirit that makes for war. We ask you to keep us confident of your love and your promise for the world. Lord, come to bless us and fill us with your Spirit. We thank you for the healing of your Holy Spirit. As we mark Reconciliation Week, so we ask, Lord, that you would continue the work of reconciliation in our land. Bring us together as one, reconciled and healed as a nation. We pray for understanding, empathy and compassion towards our First Nation people, that we may accept the realities of our history so that we may build a better future for all the people of our nation. Lord, come to bless us and fill us with your Spirit. We thank you for the gifts of your Holy Spirit. In every generation, you call ministers of your word and sacraments. We pray for all bishops, priests and deacons, and for all evangelists, pastors and teachers. Equip them to preach the gospel, to care for your people, and to show forth the fruit of the Spirit in their lives. We ask you to equip us for the work which you have given each of us. Lord, come to bless us and fill us with your Spirit. We thank you for the breath of your Holy Spirit, given us by the risen Lord. We remember all who've gone before us in the faith, remembering especially Margaret Batt and Kate Chesup. May we, with all your faithful people of every age, come to know the fullness of life you promise. Lord, come to bless us and fill us with your Spirit.
Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers.
Amen.
We are the body of Christ.
Peace
to the Lord be always with you.
Thank you.
for you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have this bread to set before you, which earth has given and human hands have made. It will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have this wine to set before you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become for us the cup of salvation. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, through your goodness we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom.
Therefore, we do as our Savior has commanded. Proclaim
proclaiming his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. As we eat and drink this holy sacrament, renew us by your Spirit, that we may be united in the body of your Son, and serve you as a royal priesthood in the joy of your eternal kingdom. Receive our praises, Father, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you in songs of never-ending praise.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Giver of life and love, we thank you that in this heavenly banquet you invigorate and renew us. Living in the unity of the Spirit, may we boldly use your gifts to continue your work in the world. Most loving God, you send us into the world to give us grace and your thanks in the power of your Spirit. Please be seated. We're now going to be presenting the Matthew McGuinness Memorial Award for 2023, and it will be presented to a young man called Isaac Brown in recognition for his dedication and service towards youth ministry within the parish of Cobram. And I ask Father Victor to please read the necessary.
Thank you, Bishop Clarence, and members of Synod and people and friends of our diocese. It gives us great joy, the people of the parish of Cobram, to nominate Isaac Brown for this esteemed award, and our parish council in Cobram gladly do so. Isaac is a year 12 learner at Cobram Anglican Grammar School, and with his family, they are dedicated members of the parish. Isaac plays the harp in the music group of the parish and is an integral part of Massey Church in the parish. Isaac, not at school only, but in the parish, excelled with youth ministry, and it really is a delight for us as a parish to humbly present Isaac Bishop to you for the Matthew McGuinness Award.
Isaac, would you please come forward? Serving the parish where the person served, with faithfulness, integrity, and utter and total commitment. In the parish as safe church officer, as church warden, as lay reader, as pastoral visitor, and even as the vicar's warden. Within the diocese, the person has wonderfully served in every capacity that he is within the diocese over the last few years. When I got to know this person, there was always this willingness to serve, and maybe in the prayer of St. Ignatius Loyola, to give and not to come to cost. As a member was part, a person was part of the bishopric election committee on four or five occasions. To one who has been a trustee within our diocese, one who has worked within the Anglican parish partnerships, one who has been part of our ministry action planning team, and one who has given loyal service to the diocese, to the bishop, and to the various committees of service, including being willing to stand for the diocesan tribunal. We'll be lucky if we have people nominating for this tomorrow, but I think we might be. One who, at the very last minute, because our esteemed advocate were not able to attend General Synod, represented us well within the diocese of Wangaratta. And I could not be more proud to offer this very first award to none other than Dr. Professor C. J. Freemantle. So I ask you to
I really cannot thank you enough for allowing me to be the person.
love and serve the Lord